Thank you. Thank you, everybody. This is so exciting. I'm so excited to be here, but I must say a bit trepidatious following three such great keynote speakers that have gone before. So I wanted to position this talk in contrast to the other three. So first of all, I thought this was going to be a Linux conference because it was linux.conf.au, so I made a title that had something to do with Linux. That'll be fine. And secondly, the three talks that went before raised deep, insightful questions about all manner of the future of open source. And the theme is the future of open source. So I'm going to sort of continue that thematic approach. But rather than pose questions, I'm going to provide answers. And since I have so many answers, because there were so many questions, this couldn't be a practical session where you really have time to explore one answer in detail, so that's why it's a keynote. And now, the difference, aside from that, the second difference is the three presenters who have gone so far have been nice people. And lastly, this will be a more technical talk. The trigger warning is this talk contains a little satire. Actually, it contains a lot of satire, and some of it is very biting. So if satire is a problem, now would be the time to take evasive maneuvers. Topia Waugh, I took some notes when she was talking, said we don't have to carry the systems of the past into the future. Change the status quo. Challenge the assumptions. So we're going to do just that, because that was very good advice. And Dan Callahan said, free licenses are not enough, and he was so correct. And Nadia pointed out that we have to think about uncomfortable issues. And so today, we're going to answer that question, which is, what is the future of free and open source software? It has no future. So the talk is in four parts. Part one is just to briefly review what the other keynoters have said about open source software, but to state it in a little balder terms, a little more direct, which is basically that free and open source software is yesterday's gravy. And therefore, we should embark on three other things. Now, I'm not saying this because I don't like free software, or I don't like open source software. Right? The thesis is there. We had this underlying aspiration that we wanted to use this new technology, software technology, computer technology, to make the world a better place, that we wanted to liberalize access to this technology so more people could take advantage of it. And there was a time when free software and open source software was a great tactic to advance that goal. Right? And the free software, maybe from 1984 to 1998, 15 years, it had a great run, was a great way to make that happen. And then open source software was invented. 1998 to maybe, 2018 would be 20 years. Right? And that's a great run. And before that, we had public software, which I was involved with. And that had a 15-year run. But that run is coming to an end, and what do we do next? So I have three proposals, which I call lithification, which I'll explain, and app freedom, which I explain, and end user development, which is kind of obvious and doesn't need much explanation. So the reason it's come to the end of the run is because all of these ideas, techniques, are based on a substrate of where the technology is today. So imagine how free software would work in an age when people program computers using punched cards, right? How would you do a merge? How would you do a pull request, right? These things, the technology has to be at a certain point in order to enable these kinds of stratagems. And then when the technology evolves even more, those stratagems no longer work because you have a new technology and you have to come up with new stratagems to work on that. So with that as prologue, we shall launch into the talk. And by the way, the hashtag yesterday's gravy would make my son so happy. Now, I'm just more direct about talking about this kind of stuff, but I'm not the only person talking about this kind of stuff, right? You're sitting there saying, Rommel is such a bozo. He thinks that open source software is over when, you know, here we are in an open source conference. Look at how, you know, open source has won, right? We know that. But, you know, Tim O'Reilly, who's a futurist, thinks into the, you know, sees it coming before anybody else. In 2008, he starts writing articles about how free and open source software is yesterday's gravy. And, you know, Doc Searle, Steve O'Grady, Matt Acey, they're all writing these articles about how open source is dead. The cloud has killed it. Oh, look, there's a new technology, right? Well, maybe it's, you know, not dead. Maybe it's just legacy, right? Or open source has won with the enterprise, but that describes the past of open source, does not describe the future, right? Or Doc Searle's very sad observation that, you know, we're winning the battle for Linux, but we're losing the battle for freedom, right? So if this is a Linux conference and we're concerned about Linux, like, yay, we won with Linux. But if we're concerned about freedom, then it's like, boo, we're losing. And you don't believe me. So we go to Google Trends. If you look at Google Trends, open source, and I go back to 2004 because that's when Google starts and you can't go back any further than that with Google Trends. This is open source, right? It's having a good run, 2004. 2006, it starts the low, slow decline into irrelevance. Free software. It has a little bump around 2006, but the same kind of a thing. And by the way, I'm searching for free software over here, so this includes all of the people who are searching for free software, where free software means software that I don't have to pay for. Like, what's going on with that? Like, free software meaning software that I do not have to pay for, people care less and less about that, and it's not free software's fault, right? If you just go for software, right, in the last 10 years, software has gone from important to irrelevant. No, you're wrong, Rommel, you're a bozo. It's not true, software is eating the world, we know that. Okay, well, so explain me this. Software, it looks like the world is eating software instead of the other way around. And so Linux, of course, what does Linux look like? Just the same thing as what software looks like. Right, it's not Linux's fault, just software is becoming irrelevant, we shouldn't blame ourselves. Now, oh! This is just Google Trends, right? This is what people are searching for. The reason the searches are declining is because now everybody knows what software is, everybody knows what Linux is, nobody has to search for it anymore, right? So this doesn't mean anything. This proves that, you know, software and Linux are winning. So let's think about that, all right? So this is a chart. We have CVS, Subversion, and Git, right? So what does the story tell, right? We start there with CVS. CVS is the version control system everybody uses, and it starts this long, slow slide into complete irrelevance. And then, you know, right at the beginning there in 2004, Subversion is positioned as the CVS killer, and it starts to rise up over there, crosses over in 2005, and you can see that it's driving CVS into irrelevance. We know that happened. It was designed to do that. And meanwhile, Git is sort of chugging along there on the bottom, and making slow progress. So about 2008, right? It starts to get some serious traction because the enterprise really doesn't care. Right? It doesn't think that distributed is going to work because you have to have centralized version control systems. But over time, and then right over there in 2010, it crosses over. You can imagine what happens in 2010, right? And it continues. And so this chart, we say, well, we have a narrative. And this narrative sort of maps onto what we think actually happened in the world, right? So yeah, this proves that, you know, Git beat out Subversion, Subversion beat out CVS, and it all makes sense. So what's the story here? And that, my friends, is cognitive dissonance. So I'll add a line in. And the line that I will add in is app. App is the green line, which is going up. And you're saying, ha ha ha, now we have proven that Rommel is a bozo. Because he doesn't even know that apps are just software. Well, and by the way, this is the talk that Chris was referring to, that you heard me give, that quote, that tweet that he did at the beginning was in reference to, is I gave this talk in 2012 at OzCon. That's 2012 right there. Right? Where if you were looking at the Google Trends going on, you're saying there's the apps going up, there's the software going down, and the title of that talk was, you know, how the App Store killed free software and why we are okay with that. Now, for those of you who think that apps and software are the same thing, I have to call up the ghost of William of Ockham. And the thing about William of Ockham is everybody, when you say that, says, oh, Ockham's razor. And it's like, yes, Ockham's razor, but that's not what Ockham was famous for during his life. So 700 years ago, the big debate was between the ontologists and the nominalists. The ontologists thought that you could take the stuff in the universe, that you could look at it and you could categorize it, put it into categories. And Linnaeus was famous for that. And then you have the animal kingdom and the vegetable kingdom, and you have vertebrates, and you can look at things and you can classify them to things. You know, people, you have the male people and the female people, and everything can be put into categories. And the nominalists say no. Categories do not exist, except as a figment of our imaginations. They're a social construct, right? What happens is that individual things exist. There's this person and that person. There's this animal and that animal. There's this plant and that plant. But any time that you create sort of this classification, this entity, which is a group, all you've done is created a social construct which has no real existence. And any time that you gain more knowledge, you could decide to change that classification. Like, what makes a chair? Oh, a chair has four legs and a back. And a stool has three legs and no back. And then you go into a bar, and there's like one leg and a back. It's like, is that a chair or a stool? Right? Oh. Right? Oh, that's a stool. Why is it a stool? Well, because, it's a stool. Right? What about a beanbag chair? It has no legs and no back. Well, it's a chair. Why is it a beanbag stool? Right? So these... And the ontologist said, no. When God made the world, he knew which ones were which, and so they actually do exist. Like, if you were to ask him, he would give you the right answer. And so if you believed as a nominalist that these categories were merely specious and evanescent, then why would you create these things needlessly? Why would you multiply entities needlessly? Right? That's the conclusion. So that's why he became, so then like, that's Occam's razor, is don't focus on these things which actually don't exist. So when you see a chart that says apps are going up and software's going down, because that's what people are searching for, there's the two sides. It's like, are apps software? And as a social construct, because apps and software are categories of things, not an individual thing. Like, when you look at an individual thing, you say, is this an app or is this software? But as categories of things, if everybody thinks they're two different categories, then that's the only reality that they have, the fact that people think that they're two different categories. Now, we could reclassify them, but pose yourself this question. Is Linux an app? Because if it is, then okay, they are the same thing. But if it isn't, then Linux is some other thing which is not an app, and apps are things which are not the same thing that Linux is, and Linux is software, so there we go. Lithification. So this great book from 2003, Small Pieces Loosely Joined, which starts talking about this unified theory of the web, because the web succeeds because it's all about small pieces loosely joined. But in fact, I remember back in, I'm running out of battery, man, that's terrible. But I remember back in the day when the whole point of Unix, the reason Unix was great, the reason Linux is great, is not because it's open source, it's because you have this idea of small pieces that can be loosely joined. Right, and that loosely joining thing was the pipe. Right, everything would read from standard in, write to standard out, and then you could compose these things in some great way, and you could do all kinds of marvelous things, and you didn't have to embed like a search facility into the list process facility, because you could just combine them on the fly. You didn't even have to write a program to do it, you could just type it right in, and these things would combine. And then you could have these small pieces loosely joined. Well, small pieces loosely joined, for those of you, and I know there's some geologists here, because I was talking to people who were saying, I'm just a bozo, I have a whole thing wrong because they're geologists and I'm not, I'm a programmer. But, I don't know if you can read this, it's grains loosely packed, right? That's the small pieces loosely joined. So small pieces loosely joined starts out, then there's pressure, and then they compact, there's this process called lithification, and then it turns into sedimentary rock. So we're going to use that metaphor to talk about what we're going to talk about here, which is to say that that's what's happening to software. That's how software differs today from what software differs to when open source software made sense. So what do I mean by that? And you can see I have a little plane icon. I was doing this on the plane. Right, so if you have some application and you want to say, oh, that's a cool thing, I'm on the browser and I want to send email, right? I click on the little button there on the bottom, and then this thing pops up and I can say, oh, take that and pipe it to some other app. In this case, I might want to do mail. Now, that's how it works in a modern environment, but if you think about sort of the history of free software, how does that work, right? You have Emacs, the canonical free software thing, right? So Emacs, a text editor, you want to send mail, what do? Well, you build mail functionality into it, right? In fact, that's Zawinski's law, right? All programs expand until they can send mail. Right? And I believe the full statement is, in those programs that cannot so expand get replaced by ones that can. Right? Well, so this is a notion that, every program, has to include everything in it, and it's not just mail, and when the world gets more complicated, then, you gotta be able to do Twitter, and you gotta be able to print from it, and you could either build all this functionality into everything that you write, and then everything gets sort of big, or you figure out a way where different apps can talk to each other, and they don't have to include their software in each other, and when you start doing that, you don't need access to the source code of those things, you just be able to need to know how you talk to them, because there's some other app that's not the thing that you're working on. Right? So every open source free software conference has to start with that founding myth. Right? Richard Stallman wanted to be able to use the printer, and he didn't have access to the printer driver, and so he decided to write an operating system so that he could have the source code to the printer driver, and that's where GNU came from. So we're going to have a new myth here. Right? So the thing that happened to me was, I was working on this presentation on the plane, as you saw, and I was saying, oh, what I want to be able to do, which I always often do in presentations, is I reference reading material. So I put in a book, and my idiom for referring to books, rather than putting in the title and the author, is I put a picture of the cover jacket on the thing, and I have an app on my Mac which does that, called Delicious Library. But I've been trying to switch over to my tablet as just kind of a thing. So I always thought, I'll just get an app that works like that for the tablet so I can do this kind of stuff on the plane. And they don't have such an app. There is no such app that does this. How hard could it be? I'll write one of those things, right? So what's the cool thing about that? Well, you just point the camera at a thing, it reads the barcode, goes to Amazon or Google Books, sucks down the metadata and stores it in a database. So you got built-in data. I'll write that. I worked on it in 2004. Which was before GitHub, before Google, before all that stuff, Stack Overflow. So I'd actually worked out how to do this barcode scanning stuff, and I lost the code because there was no GitHub, and I changed machines several times since then. So I said, I'll do it again. It'll be easier now because it's open source software. I can just go on the web, find somebody who's done this kind of thing, modify, adapt, So it turns out that in a modern operating system, there is a kernel call, an operating system call, that says, tell me what barcode the camera is pointed at, if any. And not only does that in iOS, but if you look in that, I said, is this just an iOS thing or is this an Android thing? It's like, well, it's an Android thing. Not only does it tell you, what barcode it might be pointing at, the built-in APIs say, well, what face, whose face is in the camera, viewport right now, right? Or if there's any text, could you OCR that text and tell me what text the camera is looking at? And these things are built into the operating system. There, I made it a little bigger for you. Right, so you say, well, but that's Android, right? That's not Linux, right? I said, so now we're back into the whole, Occam's razor thing, nominalism. What's a Linux? Because it's a Linux conference, we should answer that question, right? Is Ubuntu Linux? Yes, everybody knows Ubuntu. Is Android Linux? Well, Android is, Linux-ish. Some people say it is, some people say it isn't. It's got Linux in it somewhere, all right? So is Microsoft Windows Linux? Yes, actually, Linux is just the kernel, right? So if you're going to take this whole thing of GNU Linux, you have to say GNU in front of the Linux because Linux is just the kernel. Well, then in Windows, there's a Linux kernel, right? Plus this other stuff on top that's not GNU, but Windows, but okay. So then it's like a Linux, just like GNU Linux. You got your GNU Linux, you got your Android Linux, you got your Windows Linux. And this is a Linux conference, so our objective is to say, yes, once Linux kernels are subcomponents of, all computing devices, then we have won. And that's losing the battle for freedom that Tuxel was talking about. It's like, okay, well, so let's say, going back to the Google Trends, right? So what happens is, there's that blue line of Linux sliding into irrelevance, while the yellow line of Android is sort of taking over. So now, so as this thing, it's like, you know, Android is succeeding. So yes, the rest of the world agrees with you, if you're a nominalist, right? Android isn't Linux, it's this other thing which is better than Linux. Ooh, that hurt. So what should you do? You should vendor all your dependencies. You should engage in Linuxification, right? So here's the thing. The reason these commercial Linuxes are succeeding, where the free Linuxes are not, where the GNU Linux has a problem, is this legacy focus on copyright. So Google has this notion that they call vendoring, so I'm using the term vendoring here. What vendoring means is, rather than have a dependency on something else, if that something else is an open source project, you copy that source code into your GitHub repo. Right? And if it's BSD code, then you're done. Then you just change your README to say portions of the software, copyright by, and whoever the name of the person whose code you copied was, and you're good to go. And you have one such file that just lists all of the names of all the people whose code that you copied. So at the end of the day, what you will have is you will have a repo that has all of the code needed for this thing, which you can package and distribute without any dependencies. That is Lefkification. And why do we not do that? Well, we don't do that because it feels wrong somehow. It's not wrong technically, right? Technically, it's easy to show, and there's lots of places to show this, that it's a superior technical solution to the problem, right? When you have all of these dependencies, it causes so many problems. So let's just start with going back to 2000. Butler Lampson, who's the guy who arguably invented personal computing, right, gave this great talk, which turned into an article called Only the Giants Survive. And his advice there was, if you're going to use a component as a dependency in whatever project you're doing, it only makes sense to do that if it's longer, bigger than 5 million lines of code. Right, 20 million is probably a more reasonable thing. And this was in 2000, right? And so if we believe the software has gotten bigger and more complicated, we should probably up that number. It should probably increase with the cost of living or something. And so we would now say, it should be about, you know, like 35 million lines of code before you do it. And anything less than that, you should just figure out what you need from that, copy it over, and put it in your repo, and not have the dependency. Now people say, that'll never work, it'll take too long, it's too complicated. Well, we're moving into a different world. The world that we're moving into has, the software has gotten bigger on the one hand, which is the sedimentation. As things go down, you have all of this like huge amount of functionality at the low level, like facial recognition and barcode scanning built right into your operating system. And on the other level, the apps are smaller, and they need to be smaller because A, they can use all these facilities from the underlying context that they're embedded in, and B, they have a way of talking to other apps that can do other pieces of the thing, so they don't have to do everything themselves. So you have this bifurcation. Some things are getting like huge and big, and some things are getting tiny. And the deployment environments are doing the same thing, right? When you have something like Amazon Lambda, the thing that I love about Amazon Lambda, article that I read was this person was trying to deploy something which would do a little to-do app on, he included React, and React included something else, which includes something else, and then he bundled up the zip file and put it into Amazon Lambda, and the problem was that there were over 100,000 files that were called in by the recursive dependencies, and there was a hard limit on Lambda. You couldn't have more than 100,000 files in a Lambda. To do a to-do app, right? So this is the left pad thing, right? 11 lines of code to remove blanks from the beginning of a string, and it takes down the whole internet because you have 500,000 programmers who can't figure out how to solve that problem or even copy the code into their repo. It's not that they couldn't figure out how to copy the code into their repo. They could have figured out how to copy the code in their repo, but they have this social anxiety, right? This objection philosophically to copying somebody else's code and embedding it in their code because somehow that's a violation of the ethos. And I'm saying, you know, that's completely fictitious. That is creating needless entities, right? It's a violation of Occam's razor. So anyway, now, you should practice this, right? None of us individually in this room or even collectively are going to be able to build something as big as Android by ourselves, but It's a style of programming. It's a set of techniques. I spent several years doing this with Haskell. Every time I started a Haskell project, the first thing it did was I looked at how many recursive things that I would bring in if I actually did it the way, you know, that the project I was looking at was. And it was always tens of thousands of lines of dependencies. There's a whole series of techniques that you can develop, and you won't do it overnight. Like the first time you try to do it, you say, oh, this is hard. But if you keep working at it, it's like it turns out, yeah, you can remove them. Until you're including that library, it turns out you're only using two functions from it. You go in, you pull out the 22 lines of code that you needed for the two functions that you were using, and you move on. And then eventually you wind up with a thing that has no dependencies, and you've learned to do lithification, which is a skill that we're going to need going into the future after open source no longer works. All right. So the second thing I'm going to talk about is app freedom. I don't like the name. It's not really what I mean, but I don't know what to call it. So if anybody has a great idea for what to call this after you've heard what it is, you can maybe suggest something. So Brett Victor, who if you're not familiar with is, you should just Google him and read everything he ever wrote and watch everything he ever did. Among other things, said advanced programming environments conflate the runtime with the dev time. And the idea that I'm trying to get across over here is open source software, free software development, is specifically about preventing you from conflating the runtime with the dev time. That the same philosophical anti-pattern that we were talking about that prevents you from incorporating other people's code also prevents you from doing the right thing, which is realizing that dev time and runtime should not be separate, because the free software stuff is all about what happens at dev time and never about what happens at runtime. And you see this failure to understand the way advanced programming environments should work right in the four freedoms as specified. Because it starts out okay, right? The freedom to run the program as you wish, and et cetera. Except here's the thing. And I'm just gonna have to go back in history to set a little context so that we understand what I say next when I say it, because otherwise you'll think I'm a bozo. I have to put this on every time I use the word bozo. Which is, in the mid-80s, there was this problem of how are we gonna build software? Right, what's the best way to build software? And software is becoming bigger than a thing that one person can build, so we're gonna have to have people collaborating on software, and how's that gonna work? So there were several different schools. So one school of thought was, well, you just have to make everybody give everybody the source code, and then that'll make it easier for them to develop software. Right, and everybody knew that would never work. So the other school of thought was what's called object-oriented programming. And the book on that, which you should read because I have this app that lets me pull in these book cover art and put it onto my presentation, is by Brad Cox, An Evolutionary Approach, and it was, in the whole like first three chapters are talking about this industrialized model of software development where you don't need to see the source code for the thing that you're trying to modify because you have this metaphor, you have this abstraction, you have this infrastructure that lets you inherit behaviors and override behaviors. And that's inheritance. And that if you implemented this, you would never need to look at the source code for somebody else's thing, because you would take their binary object and just inherit it and override the behaviors that you want. And given that you never need to look at anybody's software, source code, we wouldn't have these issues of conflating runtime and dev time and worrying about copyrights and whatnot, and we'd be able to lithify software. We'd be able to write bigger things that were an aggregation of smaller things. Now, it turned out, of course, object orientation didn't work out. It's another legacy that we're stuck with. But, you know, that was the state of the world at the time. So the other thing about the state of the world at the time, right, we're talking right around the time, 1994. I particularly love this. You can find this sort of in the FSF archives. Right, if you wanted to buy a CD that had the source code for the GNU software, it cost you, and this is in 1994 dollars, so that's about $820 US, and maybe $1,000 Australian in today's money, if you wanted to get the source code for Linux. But of course, they did, you know, what any smart marketing corporation does, was they did market segmentation, right? If you're an individual, you pay less than if you are a corporation. Right, I didn't buy it from them, I bought it from Transameritech, because you could get it for less than $100, right? And And then a year later, they said, oh, yeah, it's only 240 and 55 or 60. Things are getting cheaper. And the year before that, it was $5,000, sort of $10,000 in today's money to get the deluxe distribution because it would compile it for you. And the reason I point this out is because the process of compiling and building Linux was so expensive, right, and so complicated and required so much equipment and expertise that they felt that they were providing a huge liberalizing service by only charging $10,000 for you to get Linux. Right? Now, you know, the world has changed, and this is no longer the case. You no longer have a value proposition where it's going to be $10,000. So the difference was, at that time, the issue was the compiling of the software and the source code, and that made it easier to do it than having to recreate it from scratch. And the reason that was the case was because anybody who was downloading the source code had a computer that they were downloading the source code onto and loading it onto, and that computer would have a compiler on it, and so you could compile the stuff. So the whole thing was reflected in the sense that the hard part was getting the source code. But we don't live in that world anymore. When you use a computer, the computer that you're using is nowhere near you, right? When you go on Google and use a computer, the computer's elsewhere. Google Docs, Gmail, right? Twitter, Facebook, anything you're doing with a computer, 99% of the processing is happening somewhere else where you can't download software to and you can't build stuff, and it's unclear that you ever want to. What you want to be able to do is take the code that you want to be able to do to change that so it behaves the way you want to do it, and you want to be able to deploy your code on somebody else's computer, which is the one that you're using. Because that's the hard part, replicating Google's 800,000 or 1.2 million or however many there are servers in your basement, right? That's a bigger impediment. That's a bigger impediment than, you know, reverse engineering the code. So you want to be able to take code that you write and run it elsewhere, and you want to be able to modify the code elsewhere if it's not doing the thing that you want it to do. Now, you're sitting there saying, oh, that is completely different, right? It's an ethical and moral imperative that if we have software, we need to share it with our friends because it is a non-rivalrous good, and anybody who is not a bozo understands that computers are not a non-rivalrous good, they're hardware. And so as hardware, it is a rivalrous good, and therefore, you can't share my computer. That would be wrong. All right, think about that for a second. What you're saying is we want to have a community that's going to help the world only for those things for which it's no skin off our noses. But, you know, and the thing is 99% of the time, you know, well, 90%. 90% of the cycles on your computer go unused anyway. They're going to waste because you're not using them because you have at best 10% utilization on whatever computers you have, mostly. Which means that, in fact, not only is it a non-rivalrous good, you're just throwing all that stuff away out of spite. You're not going to let other people use it. No, that doesn't sound right. We should let people use your computer to run their software on. That would be liberalization. And so we need to have that printer story again, right, for part two here. What I mean by printer story as well, you know, Richard Stallman, he had the printer and they wouldn't let him access the printer. So here's the story, right? When I first started with version control systems, I used this version control system called Razor, which is what NASA uses. It's awesome. Right? It comes from visible.com, you can still get it. And the thing about Razor is it had this feature, which I think everybody should have, which is you weren't allowed to check out the software because this was, you know, in the days before it was distributed. So you just change, when I say check out, just hear commit, right? So you couldn't commit the software unless you provided the issue number against which you were committing the software. Under the theory that if there were no issue, if there were no bug, if there were no, then why are you changing the software? Right? So that's just trolling. So it's okay. So it ought to work that way, right? And because you can create your own issue, right? And then that's your documentation trail. It's like, oh, go in there, create an issue, and then commit the change against the issue that you filed yourself, right? That would work. So why doesn't it work? GitHub does not work that way. I think it ought to work that way. So how do I make it work that way? Well, there's two theorems. So the first theorem says, oh, well, what you could do is if you had access to source code, which you don't because it's not open source, but that's not here nor there. So, you know, if you had access to source code, what you could do is you could reproduce all of GitHub's infrastructure in your basement, and then tell all of your friends to get an account on your GitHub copy, which has this modification that would force them to put in an issue number when they committed. Or you could convince GitHub that they ought to allow you to push in changes to the way GitHub worked for you. Which would be, and and you'd have to reverse engineer the way their stuff worked. Which is easier to do? And I say it's easier to reverse engineer. So having the source code is nice, but it's not a requirement, right? What's a requirement to give other people access to your changes, right? Freedom 3 is like, oh, you can make it easier for you. You need to be able to share your stuff so that other people can use it and benefit from your changes. It's not access to the source code that's the requirement. It's access to the runtime environment. And not only does GPL not help you with this, GPL actively prevents you from doing this. How do they actually, right? Section 6 of GPL v3, the most modern, the most latest, says, you know, if you make a modification to the source code, you can be denied access to the network if it causes a problem, violates the rules and protocols of communication across this network. And you say, oh, well, you know, that might not happen. You could say that it didn't. But, you know, let's take a cautionary tale over here, right? TCP/IP gets invented. The Department of Defense says, oh, this is awesome. We want to connect this stuff up to the telephone network. And AT&T says, no, you can't. It is our policy that you're not allowed to connect anything to the telephone network. And the Department of Defense in the United States says, are you kidding me? We're the Department of Defense. And AT&T said, yeah, well, we're the phone company. So the Department of Defense had to go to the Justice Department and said, sue these guys into oblivion so that we can connect our stuff. And after 8 years of litigation, the Justice Department broke up AT&T into eight little companies. And then the department said, oh, and part of the consent decree was, and people can hook up wires to your network, by the way. And the Department of Defense said, thank you very much. And now we have the internet, right? So GPL, so if you think that anybody who's running a computer network can't figure out some reason why whatever modification you made is a violation of their terms, you know, you are more optimistic than I. So the GPL gives these people a license to say, no, you can't run your stuff on our computer because they only care what happens in development time. GPL does not care what happens after you deploy the software in this context because they think it's two different things. So this is very, you say, well, that would never work because it's kind of basically impossible for you to put stuff on, you know, Git's website. I mean, it's a legitimate point. You would bring GitHub down if you did that. So one of the things that I did, and I wrote about this in the article that I did for opensource.com, is this mod Git, which is a thing that is a Apache mod that lets you do the following, right? So what you have is, you have a browser, it goes to the Apache web server, and it serves a file out of the file system, right? Of course. And if you wanted to have somebody else's change, which they put it in, and they would commit it there, well, where would you put that? And if you go on Stack Overflow and you ask anybody, they say, oh, well, you just put it in a different directory and create a virtual host, and then you'll have two of them. And it's like, oh, well, you know what that sort of reminds me of? That's the way we used to do version control before version control existed, right? It's like, oh, every time you have a change, just copy everything into a new directory. And we said, oh, yeah, no, well, that works, like, before you get to scale. But when you get to scale, you want to do something a little more elaborate, so we invented various things to manage that, and one of those things was Git. And so if you stuck in Git live and you went to a bare Git repo, right, you could actually specify which version of the thing do you want, and it would give you the version of the thing that you asked for. And different people could ask for different things because you could set a cookie and you could say, I want to see the test version. Somebody else could say, I want to see the beta version. Somebody else could say, and each one of them, as this thing is being served, could see the version that they had asked for. Right? And so you say, oh, give me the version that's head, you get the version that's head. And now anybody can push to the repo at any time and see the version, and the people who were using the site would only see the version that they had been requested in the first place. And not only that, the way I implemented it was you could specify the commit issue in English, like the branch, you could say, oh, give me the test branch. And on the first request, it would come back and would set the actual commit hash so that all subsequent references would use that commit hash during that session, so that if somebody changed it while you were using it, you wouldn't see the changes because you didn't want to have your session disrupted by people changing this stuff. Right? And then people say, oh, well, that would never work. Say, well, why wouldn't that ever work? Hey, you could do this in S3, by the way, because S3 also has versioning. It would just be a different implementation. And I haven't implemented the S3 version. People say, oh, that stuff would never work. And oh, by the way, you need to have the source code, right? This whole thing is, you were talking about how you didn't need to have the source code. And you need to have the source code for this whole thing to work. And I agree, you need to have the source code because this is the evolution of the human race. The future is what we're talking about, where this thing's going to go. The past is where we were, and we are at now. And now the things are the way that they are. And so this is, just like with the vendoring advice that I was giving you, a way to exercise this muscle. Even if you had the source code today, you don't know how to increase other people's freedoms by letting them modify your website at runtime. All you have is a bag of tricks that lets people modify your source code and then gives them no way to deploy it on your infrastructure. So step one, before we start aspiring to how we're going to do this for binary blobs, step one is how could we do this even if we had access to source code? And that's what I was proposing. And I call this liberal software. Why do I call it liberal software? Because every time I pitch this to people, they say, oh, well, how would you deal with security? Well, how would you deal with running it in Python CGIs and whatever? And so, first of all, I could probably answer all these questions if I spent enough time on it. But just like Nadia was talking about with maintainers becoming tired of getting all of these requests, I'm starting to feel that pressure myself. So I say to myself, I say, wouldn't it be great? Wouldn't it be great if there were some organization, some community of people who understood how computers worked, right? And they were committed to sort of liberalizing technology and taking it into the future. And they could work on these problems when they came up. And instead of saying, oh, I wish somebody else would solve these problems, they would try to figure out technical solutions about them. And they might not choose to implement them for policy reasons, but it sort of raises an interesting question of this is technology that we could build and possibly could use for good or evil. And so we should work on this. And if such an organization existed, what would we call it? Well, we wouldn't call it the free software organization, because people seeing free would think, oh, that has to do with you're not going to have to pay money for it. But luckily, in the English language, there is a word derived from the Latin word liber, which means freedom, that refers, it's an adjectival form of things referring to freedom, which is liberal. So liberal software, we can use that hashtag for what I'm talking about here. Now, you may think I'm a bozo. And certainly, Karen and Bradley do. So if you think I'm a bozo, then you need to join the Software Freedom Conservancy, because these people are the vanguard pushing free and open software into the future, right, making the world a better place and preventing people like me from ruining all of this progress. And if you think that I've made some excellent points and this might be the future, then the problem is we're at now. And in order to build that future, we need to have free software until we get there from here. So if I'm right and they just don't see the glorious future that awaits us, we still need somebody to be the rear guard who keeps the barbarian hordes from overrunning us at the pass while we bravely build this future that's coming. So in which case, if you agree with me, you should join the Software Freedom Conservancy and support them. All right, last. Yeah, my timing is pretty good here. I've got like 3 minutes. End user development. And the thing about end-user development is everybody knows what that means. So I don't have to say much about it. So we're talking about, in the beginning, there was this notion that everybody would learn how to program, right? Part of the whole open source thing was you'd have computer program for everybody, everybody would learn how to program, the source code would be a valuable resource, would make it easier for people to program, and we'd have this wonderful utopian world where everybody would program, and the fact is everybody doesn't. Right, and so Guido abandoned the CP4E, even the projects, the technical projects, I had all that stuff. Nobody's working on stuff anymore because, you know what, we don't do that. But it's making a resurgence. People are saying, everybody should learn how to program. We have these programming, 6-week intensives and all this kind of stuff. And why do we do that? Well, now the motivation is different. Right now it's like jobs. Right, you have jobs. My son, of course, is studying to be a professional ballet dancer. I can tell you this, at no audition ever has anybody asked him if he knows Python. Okay, now see you say, oh, ha, 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 that's funny, what a buzzo. Because, jobs, programmers. So. I do not make this stuff up. Right, this is reality. I just go on Google and I ask the question. And then I struggle with the answer. So the answer is, let's stop teaching people how to code and teach them how to do a rond de jambe. Anyway, so what's the most successful programming environment ever created in the history of mankind? Well, it was Lotus 1-2-3, and then everybody hated Lotus 1 because it was like the big monopoly, and everybody wanted some white knight to come in and dethrone Lotus, the spreadsheet monopolist, and we wound up cheering for Microsoft because Excel was going to dethrone Lotus, and then it became the monopoly, and we weren't cheering so much. But the thing about this is more people have solved more problems using spreadsheets than any other, and the interesting thing is you don't hear open source people say, no, convert that to a spreadsheet. Why do we not convert everything to a spreadsheet? Well, there's two, maybe three reasons. But let's go with two because I don't have that much time left. So the two reasons are reason number one, because there's no source code file that has the macro separately. It's like it's all in there, right? And what's all in there is also the data. So it's like, yeah, you should share your source code for your Lotus library, and it also has all my tax return information in it. All right, that's a problem. So maybe we should just write some command line tool using, you know, Python to do that instead, right? And then the second thing is, I can't remember what the second thing is, but anyway, the first thing will have to stand on its own. So, so end user development, I actually bought the book here, I have it in person, right, talking about, you know, all kinds of things end user development. This book's from 2006, so everything in here is at least 10 years old. But, you know, I want to just draw your attention to this thing, and I'll do it the way Jimmy Swaggart used to do it. This is a book. This is a good book. And in this good book, what it tells us is 35% of the needs can be of that people have, who are not developers, but end users, can be met by a development tool that does basic data collection, storage, and retrieval. Right, which is that access, Microsoft Access, right? You have that. And then the next 40%, all you need is 5 generic web apps that can be customizable. So now, if we're talking about liberalization and freedom and empowering people to do stuff, 75% of all that empowerment comes from these 6 applications. All the rest of it is waste. All the rest of it is just that 25%, and that was 10 years ago, right? The balance might have shifted. And of course, they point out that, you know, you could actually tailor software to be easily customizable by end users. And I'm telling you, that customization is rarely writing software in the way that the free and open source people think about writing software, right? It's configuring things differently. And, you know, if I want to change the behavior of my thermostat, I don't want to, you know, the EULA for this is 111 pages long if you download it, because that's how much free software is, and then you have to like go through all of the licenses and whatnot. I don't want to look at 20 million lines of code to modify the behavior of my thermostat. I'd like an easier way to do that. And so we all think, well, we're forward-looking people. We're talking about self-driving cars. We're talking about printing stuff, and everybody, you know, I always get that quote of Jean-Luc Picard on the Enterprise T, Earl Grey, hot, right? How about him pulling out his iPhone and going, I'd like an app that keeps track of my book collection. All right? And we could do that now. Hey, Google, I want an app that keeps track of my book collection. All right? And Siri goes, you want the cover art with that or just the text metadata? I'd like the cover art. Boom, you have an app. We can do that. I mean, you know, probably as far away as self-driving cars, but hey, we're talking about self-driving cars a whole lot. Okay, so in that scenario, right, which is just like Excel, there's a couple of things going on here. One, where's the source code, and who has a copyright to it, and what's the copyright license for that? There was no source code. I just said, give me an app, and an app appeared. I'm like, binary blob does what I want. If it didn't, I'd say, no, this sucks, give me another one. And the second thing is, how do we make these apps these days? We don't write software. We have this big neural net with massive amounts of data. Everything you ever said, everything you ever searched for, you know, every prescription your doctor ever prescribed. And you feed this a big neural net, and an app pops out the other end. Am I supposed to release all of that private data so I can make that app too? No, that would be terrible. So as we conflate the boundaries between what's data and what's program, this whole notion of free software starts to be like, hey, that actually sounds like Big Brother invasion of privacy. I'd like to keep all that stuff private, thank you very much, and I don't want to have to share it with everybody in the world. And if it isn't source code, now I know I'm over time here, but I'm going to go 5 minutes, cut into 5 minutes of your tea time over here, just to wrap it up, because I'm this close to the end. Right, now I forget what I was talking about. Oh, right. So we're getting, you know, this whole thing was built about the notion of copyright. And the interesting thing about the notion of copyright is it starts not to apply in these worlds where we're talking about self-writing software and software, you know, generated from data. The whole thing is, I mean, basically, to base all of this thing on copyright was to say, oh, yeah, no, this whole copyright thing is a good idea. And the interesting thing, you know, we have to, and nobody thinks it's a good idea, right? You go on GitHub, and it's like, most people don't have a license of any kind. There's a little bump down here where everybody said, oh, open source software really depends on people having licenses. Let's encourage everybody to write licenses. There's a big bump, and then people are like, nah. right? Because see, before 1974, you couldn't copyright software. And the reason you couldn't copyright software was considered to be a mathematical activity. It was a useful activity. When I learned to program in a language called APL. And this, for instance, is what the APL code for a Sudoku solver looks like. And if you haven't seen this video on YouTube, it's like awesome. You should definitely see it. So I know how to read this code. Many of you do not. But that's because this is mathematical code. So in those very early days, there was two conceptions of what computation was about. Right? One conception was it was a mathematical activity. And so we should call these things computers. And then the other idea was, no, it was kind of a literary activity, right? And if as a literary activity, you had to worry about the phrasing of things, and if it were literary, you could copyright it. But the problem was you couldn't copyright it because it wasn't because mostly the government thought it wasn't a literary activity, they thought it was a computational activity. And not only was it a mathematical computational activity, but it was a useful activity. So it was very important for the people who thought free software was a good idea to convince people that it was not useful. Because if it was useful, it would be patentable. And were not useful, but merely entertainment, then it would be copyrightable. So you had all these people coming out and saying, oh, software is just a way of communicating ideas amongst people, you know, literate software, you should be able to publish it as a journal article, and all this stuff, but it's not really useful, the fact that you're on a computer sort of fortuitous happenstance, but really wasn't the point. And so we invested a great deal of energy so that we could use copyright instead of patent as a way of protecting all of this stuff. And as a result, we had to strongly, strongly make the case that this stuff was not useful, it was literary. And we have succeeded with open source. I think that came out wrong. Anyway, you see the beginnings of this stuff happening today, which is, you know, there are a lot of libraries when you go to download them, they say, well, you don't want to download the whole thing. We'll make a library for you on demand, tell us the bits that you want, and we'll construct something for you. And as we get better and better tooling, we'll be able to construct those things with less and less input, and there'll be more and more variability, and people's freedoms will increase more and more, and they'll be able to deploy them into infrastructures that they don't have to manage themselves, using facilities that are sort of ubiquitous. And some of us are going to have to build that. So when people say, what was Rommel's talk about? You say, oh, it was about liberal software. And most people say, oh, OK. Yeah. And if they say, what's that? Please explain it to them. Thank you very much. Thank you for your attention.